All right, guys, welcome back for some more learning. In this video, the use of ultrasound guidance to establish peripheral IV access will be demonstrated on an actual patient. Establishing venous access is critically important and can sometimes be very technically challenging. You'll find this skill to be invaluable on the wards floor, as difficulty establishing IV access seems to be on the rise with our aging population. Our patients are living longer with worsening comorbidities like diabetes and end-stage renal disease and peripheral vascular disease, and obesity is also on the rise. All of these things make our patients quote-unquote difficult sticks. First, I want to go over a list of situations that our patients commonly face when lacking IV access and needing it a little more on the urgent side. These are all situations in which you can come to the patient's rescue with your new skill of placing an IV with ultrasound guidance. First, scheduled antibiotics or the need for first dose of antibiotics within an hour of arrival. These are patients with severe sepsis who have scheduled antibiotics, or even neutropenic fevers who hit the floor and are difficult sticks with no IV access. Our patients who are on continuous drips of any kind. Heparin drip is a great example in our patients with PE. Frequently dosed IV pain medications. Patients with sickle cell pain crisis on PCA pumps, or our cancer patients with large tumor burdens and pain from malignancy. Blood or platelet transfusions in active GI bleeders or pancytopenic patients who require blood products. Phlebotomy for frequent or urgent labs is a big one. This can delay discharge when the only thing you need that morning is a creatinine to show that the patient's improving and you can send them home, but alas, no IV access, no labs overnight. Cardiac markers in patients with chest pain can be fairly urgent. And then PCV in patients with suspected GI bleed, also very important. There's a couple situations in which you'll be able to come to the rescue, and they happen a lot, guys. Okay, guys, let's start talking about how we're actually going to get down to doing this thing. An ultrasound-guided peripheral IV can be performed after obtaining verbal consent alone. And it requires only clean technique as opposed to sterile technique. There are really only a few items that will be needed. You can see them here. One, an IV starter kit that has all sorts of goodies in it, including a tourniquet, tubing, a cute little tiny baby ChloraPrep, as well as a Band-Aid that's clear to place over the IV to secure it. You'll also need a few normal saline flushes to ensure that you've reached your source and that you have patency with the ability to draw and flush. And then your choice of IV that you wish to place. I personally only go for the upper arm, the basilic vein, and I use this 18-gauge, 2.5-inch needle. It's a little bit specialized and found only in the central supply, but not to worry, I keep our supply cart Gus fully stocked with this needle. Once monthly, I'll restock them. Okay, now we've got our equipment, but before we go poking anybody, let's just take a quick look at our anatomy. Here is a view of the right upper arm, which is the territory that we'll be going into. You see there's a couple of options. You have a basilic vein, brachial veins, typically there's two that flank the brachial artery, and then a cephalic vein, a little more lateral. And I prefer the basilic vein, and I'll tell you why. On this next slide here, you can see the same right arm, except we've got a cross section of the arm and we're looking up the right mid arm here. And you can see the basilic vein actually is one of the larger veins. It's typically no less than about 8 millimeters in diameter. It also tends to be fairly superficial on the medial side of the arm. And it's typically the most easy to access and the closest option. You do have the cephalic vein. It's out lateral and it is always very superficial. The only problem is it's typically no greater than about 8 millimeters in diameter. So you put yourself at a disadvantage. It's trying to cannulate the smaller cephalic vein, although it is superficial and can be accessed easily just under the skin. The brachial veins, sometimes you see one that really lends itself nicely to being cannulated. It's outside of a dangerous zone, but typically you'll see that brachial veins will flank the brachial artery. Not only that, there will typically be a median nerve bundle in the area, either, you know, just between you and the brachial veins or just distal to them. So that can be a tricky area to poke. I personally look for a good basilic vein and go for that. Here we have the same cross-sectional view looking up the right upper arm here on an ultrasound. And you can see here the basilic vein, very nice and plump, closer to the surface as well. The brachial veins are flanking this brachial artery here, and you can see pretty nicely here the median nerve bundle just hugging up to the brachial artery, a little bit deeper from that brachial vein that's more superficial. This is one of those reasons you kind of want to stay away from this area. It's very busy. Make sure you take the time to correctly identify artery from vein. Usually applying just a gentle amount of pressure makes it very obvious, as veins are easily compressible and arteries will maintain their round form when you apply pressure. The other thing you'll notice after applying pressure is that arteries will typically be visibly pulsating on the ultrasound. If you want to turn on color Doppler, that would be one more way to confirm artery from vein and distinguish the two so that we don't go hunting for an artery. All right, guys, finally now let's meet our patient and talk about the next important steps to being successful. First, you have got to apply the tourniquet. If you don't have that tourniquet on, you are not going to see much. So make sure you put your tourniquet on. Second, positioning is very important. In order to see that basilic vein and have great access to it, you want to have the patient extend their arm upward and put it behind their head. I like to say to pose like a supermodel. Now take that cute little baby ChloraPrep that you've got in your IV starter kit and clean the surface of the area that you'll be going at with your IV. Be sure to apply a generous amount of ultrasound jelly to your ultrasound probe and make sure you take your time on this next step because you want to find the best possible vein that's going to make you successful. When looking for the vein, you want to use the rule of twos. You want a vein that's no more than 2 centimeters below the skin, a vein that has at least 2 centimeters of straight, non-tortuous length with no branches, and no major turns or bends in it. And then you want to find a vein that's at least twice the diameter of the gauge of the IV that you're using to cannulate it. If you follow those steps and take your time looking for the best possible vein, you will be successful. Okay, let's say you found the perfect vessel and you're just about to take a stab at it. Pause right there and make sure you've done one very important thing. You've got to have your targeted vessel in the center of your ultrasound screen. And that's because this will mean your ultrasound probe is centered right over the top of it. And then placing your IV on the skin in the center of your ultrasound probe will mean that you are in the direct path right over that vessel, and as you apply pressure and poke inward, you should be directly over your targeted vessel. Don't skip this step. This is maybe the most important one to ensure you've done very carefully. In this demonstration, we're starting with a short axis view, which makes the vessel look like a round target. And then once we've advanced our needle and we can clearly see it in the center of the vessel as seen here, we will then move to a long axis view in order to finish the job. Going short axis helps you come in directly over the center of the vessel, and then going long axis helps you to ensure that not just the bevel of the needle has entered the vessel, at which time you may see a flash of blood, but also the lumen of your plastic sheath catheter has crossed that important endothelial layer as well, in order for you to successfully cannulate the plastic sheath into the vessel, which is the thing that will remain in the vessel and is the most important thing to reach that targeted vessel. Now, just when you thought we were ready to finally poke this patient, I got one more thing to say. I know you guys are being real patient, but this is important. Pick an angle for your needle that's about 45 degrees. If you go too shallow, you'll use up too much of your needle trying to reach your targeted vessel, and you'll have nothing left to actually cannulate the vessel with. If you go too steep, then you're going to expect your plastic sheath to make a real sharp turn, and that will most likely lead to kinking of your catheter sheath after you've withdrawn the rigid needle. Pick a 45 degree angle. That's your best bet. Feel free to shallow out as you've reached your vessel, but not until then. All right, guys, we're finally ready. We've got our vessel centered on the ultrasound screen. We've got our needle centered on the ultrasound. Go ahead and make that initial poke real quickly, because this is the part that's most painful for the patient. Now, from here on out, your eyes should really just be on your ultrasound screen. In this short axis view, you're advancing your needle, and it should show up as a bright white hyperechoic spot. Scouting out that dot as you advance, being careful to see the tip of the needle enter into the vessel until you've got that target on the bullseye shot. Here's another great clip of scouting out that needle on a short axis view until you've reached your vessel. Once you've got that perfect needle on the bullseye shot, you're now ready to go long axis so you can see the entirety of your needle for that final approach and final cannulation of the plastic sheath into the vessel. And here's what that long axis view with final cannulation of the vessel should look like. Pay close attention on this step. Here's another clip of the same process. And then here's a final clip going from short axis to long axis without any interruption, where you can see we're scouting out the tip of our needle as we're making the approach to our targeted vessel. And then, right before we actually enter that vessel, right before we see that needle on the bullseye shot, we actually are going to go long axis before entering the vessel, and then seeing the entirety of our needle and plastic sheath, we continue on to long axis as seen here. Woo! That was awesome, guys. It feels so good. Now, what I like to do is just take one more little look-see at my catheter within the vessel, just to confirm one more time I'm right on the spot. All we've left to do now is remove our needle, and you'll see a little trickle of blood. Don't worry if it gets a little messy. We're going to attach our plastic tubing. Might want to make haste on this part. And then we'll attach a normal saline flush and just ensure that our catheter is functioning properly. Now, clean up the area right around your IV. So that it's nice and dry, and then apply this clear see-through Band-Aid as such. Now, I've just got one more little pearl for you before I let you go. You may have noticed that I was holding the needle in a special way with my thumb and my middle finger. This leaves the index finger free to advance the plastic sheath when you're in that critical crunch time. On long axis, you can see your bevel of your needle. You've also cannulated far enough for your plastic sheath to be in the vessel, and it's finally time for you to advance that plastic sheath. This This method will allow you to manipulate your needle and have your index finger free for advancement of the catheter. And that's it, guys. We did it. We feel awesome. We are awesome. I hope you've enjoyed this instructional video, and happy sticking long into the future. Don't sweat the petty, don't pet the sweaty. Over and out.